It's Sunday, and that means one thing. It's time to bring you another fantastic slate of racing here on Racesport TV and on iRacing Live. And we kick it off with the ever-popular iRacing Formula Renault 2.0 Championship. It's live from Oulton Park, and it starts after these messages.
Simulated racing can be awesome, but can also be kind of a free-for-all. Interestingly, auto racing faced the same problem in its earlier days. Whether it was on the back roads, the beaches, or the city streets, the racing was fun, but there was always a certain level of chaos and danger, until some folks came along and put some order to all of this. Stuff like official racetracks, regulations about weight and equipment, and enforcement of standards. That's what gave us high-speed excitement, fast-paced action, and photo finishes. That's when racing became racing. The guys over at iRacing.com have made the same transformation in the world of sim racing. Sure, they've got the most accurate tracks and realistic cars out there, but that's just the start. See, iRacing analyzes the performance and results of each driver in every race, so you can be sure you're always placed in races where the competition will be tight, and that those reckless drivers who ruin it for us all are kept in the pits. Not to mention that with over 45,000 active members already in their vast community, you can find races day and night, so you can always get in on the action. You can even join a league of your favorite series. And since updates are always automatic, you don't have to worry about software and can focus on the track. Zip up your fire suit and check out iRacing.com.
So I'm Dan Garrison, engineer at iRacing, been working on dynamic track and wanted to take the lab coat off to kind of give an update on what I've been doing to enhance things on the asphalt side, what we're kind of calling the dynamic track version 2. When we started looking at dirt and the interaction between the tire and the track, kind of pointed us to some things we could improve on the asphalt side as well. We were able to kind of rework the calculations that account for heat transferring generally in the direction from the tire to the track. The track will cool a little bit faster when cars are not on it, but more significantly, cars running on the track are going to impart more energy into it, bringing the temperature up and changing the racing experience so that you do have to be wary of the track getting hot and reducing your grip. I've been rethinking some of the calculations that determine kind of how the rubber is torn, whether it's how much is torn from the tire, how much is torn from a rubbered in track. I've made some changes so that rolling tire will pick up more rubber. We also looked at the thickness of the rubber under the contact patch and realized we can make improvements to the model there. As a result, we're able to make the tire respond a little bit more to how much rubber is there. We're able to influence how fast the track rubbers in areas where the tires are working hard. So I'm excited about these changes that we're making. The temperature in the track is going to be a lot more dynamic. It's going to mean you're going to have to dive around looking for the cool parts of the track. I think it's going to make the different lines come in and change the racing experience. And I'm really kind of excited to see how this is going to change things following the September build when it comes out.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Little Budworth in England, and welcome to Sunday here on Racesport TV and on iRacing Live. We are getting ourselves ready to go racing here in the Formula Renault 2.0 Championship. 19 laps worth of racing around this Oulton Park circuit. Wolverton along with Jake Sperry. Let's show you then your starting grid for this event. It's up on your screen. Well, Jake, what we can see is that Peter Behrman doesn't have it all his own way this time around.
Oh, he doesn't. Lucas Gotch on pole position, 1:29 flat with his second lap time of the afternoon. I've had the pleasure of working alongside with Lucas Gotch. Fantastic work ethic he has, and he certainly pulled out all the stops to beat a very established driver such as Peter Berryman. But there are surprises up and down the field. Don't count out Lando Norris in fourth position. Angus Waddell will always challenge in fifth. You look down the field though, down to the very back, the likes of David Jarvis there did not manage to set a lap time, starts in 21st. We're in for an absolute cracker, Will.
Oh yeah, we are. And this is a track where sometimes passing can be hard. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens here today as we get a look from up above here. There is your pole position driver, Lucas Gotch, looking to go light to flag here, but he's going to have lots of competition. Peter Berryman is just alongside him on that front row of the grid. Don't forget, not one, not two, not three, but four races coming your way today here on RaceBot TV and on iRacing Live. We've got ourselves a classic IndyCar series later, then of course, traditional Sunday night action with Formula Renault 2.0 World Cup. Then we round things off with the final round of the iAdvance Indy Elite Series Triple Crown presented by Ricmotech. And that will be at the legendary Tricky Triangle Pocono Raceway. But let's think about here. Let's think about now. There you can see your starting grid. They are lined up. They are assembled. They are ready to go racing. Lights go on. Light will go off, and let's get this show on the road. 19 laps, green flag in the air, as these guys will storm it down in towards one for the first time. This is a tough corner, Old Hall corner. Will they survive that first corner? Well, we're about to find out, Jay. Oh, we got one, two cars turn around already. Three cars.
Yeah, Greg Sykes, certainly one of those turned around. Also the car of Takahiro Ishikawa there, secondary incident. Bill Fraser, the other car, turned around. Let's see what's happened between those two. And oh, it just looked to me as if it was one incident into two. David Williams involved in a bit of contact. One going off on his own, Bill Fraser, and the other one, Greg Sykes, gets a tap around.
Yeah, so we saw all of that there. Let's go back towards the front of your field because Peter Berryman has taken over the lead of this motor race.
Yes, he has, and now he's got to try and stretch his legs and run. This is a very difficult circuit to make overtakes on. He'll use that to his advantage. Isn't really too much of a long straightaway to make this move, but up the hill, downhill is going to be a great opportunity to possibly send one down the inside, but you've got to be so careful around here, Will. You look at these insides of these chicanes with those tyres just ominously placed there. Tap one of those and your suspension's ruined.
Yeah, I think there'll be some people that look at this racetrack and think, oh, if only we had it at Circuit of the Americas. On board with the driver of Nick Thiessen there in the number 10 car as he heads himself through this fantastic right-hand corner. That is Druids underneath the bridge down into Lodge, turn number 16 on this track. And it's worth bringing it to the attention of the viewers here today, Jake, that there's so many different combinations here at Oulton Park today. We are running on the one that has got both the Britons and the Hislop chicane.
Yeah, of course, it's the longest layout that we have here around Oulton Park, which means for a very interesting lap, you've got to make sure that you get everything correct. It's very easy to go into the wrong practice session, get the wrong layout sorted, so you have to be very vigilant, very uptight and precise with every little placement that you get. There are some very difficult corners. Britain's certainly one of them. A one-line suits all off-camber chicane. That one's going to be very interesting, but at the moment, four-car train breakaway.
Yeah, that's right. I'm bored of Peter Berryman. Down this back straightaway, we'll show you how hard this section is. This is the first chicane. It's a little bit like Le Mans. It sounds funny to say that. It's a very shortened version of Le Mans, just with a hill there as well.
Yeah, most certainly. It does look quite a lot like the Mulsanne straight right now. You can see first little chicane. Now here comes the second, a large chicane here of Hislop's. It is reversed, however, to what is the Le Mans chicanes. Normally it's right, left, then left, right. This time we're going to flip it around and inverse it and mirror it and what have you. But now you can see heading up through the hill, now heading up towards Druids. You can see Lando Norris just tagged on the back of this group. Silvasti waiting very patiently behind Lucas Gotch. You don't have to make a move so early on, but with 19 laps, there certainly will be a bit of impenitence later on.
Nick Thiessen versus Mark Jarvis, battle for P6, P7. Jarvis has been passed by Nick Thiessen. They're looking to go side by side once again. And you see Thiessen there on the outside, inside line, Mark Jarvis. And that pass is going to be scored complete by him. He moves himself now back past Nick Thiessen. Out front, Lucas Gotch is currently classified as 0.7 of a second behind your race leader. One may argue right now that he's actually holding up the likes of Yuni Sebasti and also Lando Norris. Norris right on the coattails of Yuni Sebasti as they head themselves now down this very tough island bend down into Shell Oil's corner.
Yeah, definitely. It's going to be very difficult to find a way past. Of course, this corner also banked to the inside, which means that you can throw that car in a lot quicker than you'd normally expect. We have seen cars locking up that front right quite regularly down into that corner. That's going to be something very interesting to look out for, that maybe the tyre wear on the front right might start to wane a little bit towards the end of the race. But for the time being, Berryman, as I've said before, stretching his legs. We do know that Alex Simpson's watching Team Boss of Apex Racing UK, so pressure's certainly on for the Apex Racing boys.
Oh yeah, you always know when the boss is watching, you've got to be on your best behaviour. Got to make sure you don't mess up. Hugo Prieto right now behind Nick Thyssen. Thyssen is falling down in your field a little bit here today. And now also you have got this driver, the number 17 machine of Yuhani Salkivi. There we are. We got it right the second time around. But Lando Norris, let's go back to him. He's running himself in that fourth place right now. You have got a top four breakaway. Angus Weddle there in the fifth position, 1.5 seconds back. Well, that is not an insurmountable gap there for Weddle, as he heads himself past the start finish time, and he's just hanging on. Having a look at the last lap times, he's actually half a second slower, so he's now got the chance with that clean air to pick up the pace. Lando Norris, so right on the inside, looks to the inside, can't get it though, down into Cascades, or can he? He's trying to find a way past, wasn't able to do so. He'll be a brave man to try and do it into Island Bend, but this is a brave man. Lando Norris then to the inside and pushes him off.
Yes, he does, and that is very unfortunate for Sebasti, who does collect the tyres on the front, and he'll be very upset about that one. Reverses the car, can get it going again, so kept the engine running, but that was a really frustrating manoeuvre there. We know it was dangerous coming down in, but maybe a little bit too dangerous. They had to leave the room. The room wasn't exactly given enough. Incident that happened there, not ideal. It's now a breakaway of three. Now Angus Weddle pushing himself up into fourth position. And going back to a point here on Nick Thyssen, the last time we were checking with him, did a 130.8. Second slowest man on track, gets massive wiggle through his lops wheel. Very, very difficult to work out whether Thyssen's actually got a problem of some sort.
Yeah, well, just having a look at his car, doesn't seem to see any damage on there, unless it's something that was suspension based only. That car looks fine to me.
Well, definitely, and there's also been a couple of engine issues that I've been seeing throughout the week here with these Formula Renaults. That might be something that just plays into the mind a little bit, that your top speed can just be affected a little bit. Seems to have sorted the problem out here behind Mark Jarvis, but you know, Hugo Prieto, a very quick driver, won the 2K Cup at Circuit of the Americas, so can certainly put the pressure on and can certainly find himself a lot of pace.
Yeah, let's go back though to that incident with Lando Norris, because I said, as it was happening, it's a brave man to try and pass on the inside of Island Bend. Of course, you want to get that pass complete, and we're going to ride on board again and try and explain to you why. Because the next corner, of course, is that banked right-hander. You can go side by side, you can hold the outside line, but Lando Norris said, seems to have just drifted up the racetrack a little bit, and that is why, well, Sebasti now is right down the rear of your field. In fact, as far as I can see, it's on pit road.
Yeah, it's a real shame. I think Lando Norris did come off his line quite a bit there. He could have stayed over to the left-hand side if he carried a little bit less speed. He thought that the gap was maybe clear, but in the end it wasn't, so it hasn't worked out. But what is happening right now is you can see Peter Berryman took another 0.3 right now here, Will, out of Lucas Gotch. Gotch is only 1.3 seconds behind, probably a little bit closer, as it seems he has closed up potentially a little bit in this next lap that we've just seen right now. So Gotch certainly not giving up the ghost at the moment. Peter Berryman isn't clear by any stretch of the imagination right now.
Yeah, 1.1 second actually. That gap is remaining static now at just over a second, right on board of Torben Fairhair in the number 23 Club Diat machine. David Taranto there in the number 13 Club France car. So they just now head themselves exit of Druids down Warwick Bridge into Lodge Corner they come, and the gap between these two drivers was pretty much nothing at the halfway point of this lap. It'll be worth seeing whether Torben Fairhair will be able to get himself past. He's up one place so far in this mud race. They come past the start finish line again. 131.3 flat there, that last time by for Torben Fairhair, as he continues to try and reel David Taranto, who runs himself in that 12th position, up four places actually for Taranto. One of your biggest movers in your field this afternoon.
Yes, he is, and Torben Feiler can't really find a way through at the moment. You can see loses a lot of time there down through the Cascades, and
Jarvis now out.
Sorry, what?
Jarvis is out. Jarvis has just had an issue.
Oh my word, that is an absolute shame. It's David Jarvis, not Mark, which is going to be the one benefit heading out in this situation. So David Jarvis, his bad day, starting at the back of the grid, ends in tears.
Yeah, and he just catches it there on the exit of turn number one. And it's one that is very easy to do in some ways. It's a bit like turn one of Watkins Glen. We now have ourselves another driver off. This is down at your first chicane. This is Britain. We're going to try and see if we can get ourselves another look at this one. Exit of the corner. Just a little bit too heavy on the gas pedal. Josef Vladkoren there in the number 18 machine, just looping it around. But that turn number one, Jake, is very much like the turn one out at Watkins Glen. I'm going to ride on board of Lucas Scott to try and explain what we mean here. But it's natural to just kind of push a little bit wide on the exit of the corner. You've got that large rumble strip like you kind of have at Watkins Glen. But you catch it wrong, it's bye-bye race car.
Yeah, it's a very difficult corner. What is very understated about this from the cameras, it's incredibly bumpy down in towards turn number one. There's one iconic bump there, which is just annoying, just on the racing line, which is just enough to unsettle the car enough. And everyone's got to try and adapt as well as they can around it. And it's so difficult that you often see quite a few incidents happen down at turn number one, not just because it's a very difficult corner, just because drivers switch off the pedal, think it's a normal corner, just turn their minds off, and it just creates that one little incident where cars just flick themselves around and it doesn't work out, and everyone's just got to be on the 100% every single lap around here, Will.
David Zaranzo right now is continuing to scrap it out with Toplin and further in the battle for P number 11 as it is right now. Fantastic camera shot from the rear of David Zaranzo through Britain chicane. This is now down Hislop's into the Hislop chicane, which of course leads immediately into the Knickerbrook corner. And you can see the amount of throttle control needed through that second chicane as well, Jake.
Oh yeah, definitely. You've got to be very, very vigilant and very patient with applying that throttle. It's a right to a left to a right again. It's so easy just to put too much on it, especially with these cars struggling on low speed conditions, have a tendency to spin the rears up enough to spin the car around. So you have to be very careful. You've got to be very precise. Kind of reminds me, say, of a Casino Square sort of area from the Monaco race circuit. Just because you've got to be just so precise in, so precise out, it doesn't really matter how you really hold it. It's just about how much speed can you carry through the corner and how much you will sacrifice on the exit.
Right, there's your top eight then, bottom of your screen. Peter Berriman is maintaining that gap to Lucas Scott. It's 1.4 seconds on track right now. The gap between P1 and P2, pretty much the same to P3 and P4. Lucas Scott's running himself in second, Lando Norris in third, Angus Waddle in the fourth position. But it's Mark Jarvis running himself in P5 right now, who has been able to eke out a gap to Nick Thyssen. Thyssen now falling under the pressure of Hugo Prato. And then we've got ourselves, Solo Kiwi, rounding out your top eight as it stands. In terms of retirees, David Jarvis is down. Eunice Sebasti, of course, we know he's at the very rear of the field, but he's still classified on the lead lap as it stands. Riding ourselves then on board with Peter Berriman. He leads this motor racing. Last time by, he did himself a 129.291, his fastest lap of the day, Jake.
Yes, he's really showing that he wants to keep going quicker and quicker and quicker still. The only thing that is to be of a worry here is that instant limit there, because he did set that fastest lap whilst also taking an instant limit point, but he goes even quicker still, a 129.154. He is flying at the moment. It's Peter Berriman. Look at the car behind Lucas Scott. Only a 129.6, another half a second. He eats the gap up to 2 seconds, and catching's one thing, passing's another. Norris took 0.2 out of Lucas Gotch, and potentially now, with a 1.4 second gap, Gotch now might just have to start thinking about behind.
And it's worth noting as well that it seems to me that Peter Berriman is just controlling this race as it stands. It's one of those drivers, Peter Berriman, he can just flex his muscles when he needs to, and I call it that 95-98% range. The best drivers don't run 100% flat out every lap. They have a little bit in reserve in case they, and yes, we know his trademark, need to go hammer time, so to say. And Peter Berriman's one of those drivers. He can, when he needs to, just find those extra 0.2 of a second on track. And people will wonder, well, why don't you just run it flat out all the time? Reason is, on a track like this especially, Jake, it sometimes just isn't worth it, especially because of those ominous tyre barriers.
Oh, definitely. You have to make sure that you are controlling the race. It doesn't matter in the end how much you win a race by, it just matters that you win a race. Now you can see David Zaranzo under threat again from Torben Feiler, down into the right left of Hislop's then, but now you can see Soranzo back on the aggression here with Dan Nygaard there just ahead of him as they head up now, heading towards Druid, which will soon be coming up the right-hander. And now you can see this is what makes it so difficult, Will. It's one line suits all for pretty much two-thirds of the circuit, if not three-quarters. You get onto the back of someone, but then the corner just opens up for one line. You cannot run anywhere, really, side-by-side.
Yeah. In fact, let's ride a lap on board with David Soranzo, because this is a fantastic scrap for the last step on the top 10. Exit of the final corner, running wide, and Soranzo, well, he could be under pressure now. He is under pressure. Troubling Fairhair will look down to his inside, in towards turn one, Old Hall corner, and Soranzo able to just keep it round the outside there. Fantastic racing. And what this now means is Troubling Fairhair is going to be passed by Peter Simlek there. Or will he? No, not just yet. Little bit of argy-bargy. They keep it on the track, and well, Simlek there falling back in line.
Yeah, Peter Schmalek there really looking for an opportunity through. Didn't quite happen then. And now you can see that left-hander just stops the momentum down to the right-hander. Big twitch there on the brakes from Torben Feiler. He just can't get back into the rhythm. And actually, Schmalek's going to run wide. Through will go the car of Claudio Candio. Through will go Greg Sykes, recovering from a lap one incident. And now, you have to say, everyone getting a little bit impatient here on lap 10, Will. We're halfway through this motor race, and already we're starting to see the errors creep in.
Yeah, you talked about tyre wear. Well, that is the situation on Simek there. Just trying to push too hard out the corner. I think he smelt the opportunity to try and lean himself up to a pass into Britain's. And then, of course, because he got too aggressive on the noisy pedal, wasn't able to make the pass because he pushed wide. In fact, he lost more than he gained. Soranzo then versus Nygaard continues back on board with David Soranzo. And oh, Hugo Prieto is out of this motor race for the time. Well, he's not, he's off. Let's get ourselves a second look at that one. Hugo Prieto. Let's have a look on board as he comes down in towards Lodge Corner. I think this might just be a simple spinneroonie. Yeah, over the crest. And of course, he just depressed there as you come down the hill. And that corner, it reminds me so much of a couple of others. It's so difficult to make sure you get the acceleration right on corner exit. Didn't work that time for Hugo Prieto. Now down into P number 9.
It's such a difficult corner, that final corner, because you're coming down in, you're trying to get yourself on the power as quickly as you can, and of course the track going downhill, going away from you, making it even more difficult to just put your foot on the noisy pedal. And he just got on a little bit too late, not enough for him, car spins around, and he's very lucky he didn't catch the car of, say, Juhani Salavicki right there, because he was ever so close to the rear of what was Hugo Prieto at the time. So you can really see everyone now starting to struggle a little bit. Maybe, just maybe, minds are starting to switch off with the lack of battling going on. But still, Soranzo and Nygaard going on into Hislop's. And again, you can see they're going to train up like Monaco, but still can't find a way through.
Yeah, Greg Zietz as well, trying to make a pass over Claudio Candio. And of course, you also saw the replay of David Williams. He made exactly the same mistake as Greg Zietz. Not Greg Zietz, you know who I mean. But he put it into the tyre barriers. So now David Williams is out of this motor race. Lots happening then here at Oulton Park. And don't forget, this is one of two Formula Renault races we've got going on this weekend at this racetrack. A little bit later on today, we bring out the 2K guys. And that'll be live. That'll be 9 p.m. in the UK. That's 8 p.m. GMT here live only on your home of RaceBot TV primetime on iRacing Live. Fantastic battle there going on down in P number 14, 15. I have a correction to make. It's not motor racing based, but it does apply in some cases. You say it doesn't matter how much you win by. I think Jessica Ennis will tell you otherwise after her 800 meter win yesterday.
Oh, well, that's a multi-class events race, which means that you score your points where you can. It's the same as a championship. It doesn't matter how many points you win by in your remaining race. It's about the overall standing. So different circumstance. But again, Soranzo under pressure now, started to fall back from Nygaard, which allowed Torben Feiler to close up. And because Feiler was so close, they had to back off of it. And now Claudio Candio starts to close in on the gap, Will. So you really do have to be choice about where you make the moves. The chicanes, you won't really get a sniff in. You've got to do it down into what is the shell oil corner.
Yeah, I'm just having a look at the replay here of Torben. Because he comes out of the corner, and this is what you mean. He gets such a good run, but there's nowhere for him to go. He has to back off the noisy pedal, because it is pretty much single file for Britain. And as a consequence, we have seen people pass the Britons. It's a tough way to do it though. You've got to have a lot of cooperation between your drivers. And as you were just talking about now, Candio is right there in the mix as well. It's a three horse battle, P11, 12, 13.
Yes, it is. And now heading down to the walls, the front straight away, and now in towards turn number one, that very difficult turn number one we've seen too many times. Gap at the front stretched to 2.5 seconds, Will. So you have to say at the moment it's Peter Berryman walking away, but Candio still searching down in towards the Cascades. They come along, left-hander here, and you can see contrasting lines taken there. Candio takes a lot of a tighter line, won't mean he gets a good enough exit. Viler there was setting up for that second part of the apex, and there you can see down in the slipstream, Candio gets close here at Island, but not quite close enough here, Will, because he has to stay behind just for one moment.
Yep, and they exit now, Shell Oil's corner back on board with Candio. You can, if you get a very good run through Britain, try and make the move down into Hislop. Not going to happen though for Candio. You're back to single file. At the front of this field though, gap between Berryman and Gott is up now to 3 seconds.
3 seconds is pretty decisive in my book, Will, especially with the fact that we've got 5 laps to go now in your motor race. Berryman just crossed the line, did another 129.169. Look at the lap times he's putting in. That was only fractions of a second off of his quickest lap time all race long, and he's really showing exactly what he can do right now. But you got to just stay careful right now, because that gap has stayed at 1.4 between Gotch and Norris, so still everyone's got to get around 97%. Car turned around, Will.
I don't know who it was. I just saw a car turn around. I don't know who it was or where it was though, but there has just been a car turn around somewhere. We'll try and find it. I think it was Greg Zietz actually, because he's falling down like a lead balloon. So Greg Zietz,
I believe it's Joseph Falgren, if I'm correct there, Will.
Oh, okay. Shall we have a look anyway and see what happened?
Yeah, I think so as well, because that's a really, really interesting one to see right now, because there's just a couple of incidents here, a couple of incidents there, where everyone's just starting to struggle just a little bit. Not quite sure who's gone where, but, you know, it's one of those things where you have to be very careful about where you place it. Tiredness, possibly a factor with 5 to go.
Yeah, well, we're on board with Falgren right now. I've got a feeling it was one of these two drivers, turn number one. We can't find anything right now, but I know it happened down into turn number two. If it was anywhere, nope, nothing. Sorry, we'll try again later. We saw the back end of a crash, a spin at the very least. We just don't know where it was. Unfortunately, our timing screens, because it was such a fast recovery, didn't really show up as an incident for us. But let's have a look then down at this ongoing battle with Nygaard, Taranto, P10, P11, 5 laps to go. And that's the thing, these laps take off so quickly here. Yeah, they're 1 minute 30 laps, but you are working for a minute 30 here. It's not like certain tracks where you get yourself big breathing spaces here, Jake. You don't get to breathe at this track.
Oh no, you don't. And Falgren's going to try and be opportunistic down to Lodge, down on the brakes on the inside, takes the position very nicely, cut back, coming back potentially for Schmalek, doesn't get a good enough run, won't happen. Now Greg Sykes just ahead, will try and find a way through on Claudio Candio, can't quite get the move sorted into turn number one, just not quite close enough. 2-3 tenths, you've got to be within 2-3 tenths around here. It's not like a circuit of the Americas where you have to be within 6-7 to make the move down the long back straight. There is no long back straight. There's potentially this, the longest straight on the circuit, but you've got to be careful. Sykes running wide there, Will, has to be very cautious there about putting that car wide, because it's so easy to throw yourself off.
Yeah, and we talked about the fact that, you know, it is so easy to lose this race car, especially here on the exit of this corner. Acceleration is important at this racetrack. Of course, the track getting a little bit dustier now as well, and that's going to make it harder for these guys to try and make an overtaking opportunity. I will say one thing, Jack, it's been fantastic here, looking at the battles down your mid-pack, because they have been the class of the racing field here today. I'm going to go back on board with David Taranto, P number 10. He's not far away past Dan Nygaard, but my God, this has been fantastic battling.
Yes, it certainly has. We have certainly seen quite a few great things going on here, and this battle's continue to just work itself on, keep itself going, and really showing here, Will, just what the back of the field is made of, that everyone is fighting for one very important reason: we want to race.
Yep, and of course these guys running in the official Formula Renault series, they have the opportunity to do 4 races a week really and get the best points of that taken towards their championship. They race more than 4 times, well, they take an aggregated score of their best two races, if it's less than eight races, so on and so forth. But these guys, they are thinking championship points here. And this is one of the biggest point scoring events of the week. So just because you finish P5 and you don't win, it doesn't necessarily matter.
The contact, Greg Sykes turns around Canio, and also the car there of Joseph Valgren, Will, down to the cascade, all gone horribly wrong, and they were threatening to go too wide, Will, and it's all ended in tears.
Well, yeah, we were talking about points there, and sometimes just because you're in a big points race doesn't mean you have to go for every position. They were looking for every position there, and that is what happened. Synchronized spinning, 6.7, I would give that one. But wow, Joseph Valgren involved in that one. We're going to get ourselves one more. Look at that. Oh my word. Big, big drama then towards the end of this motor race. On board with Valgren, because he is right in the center of this. And realistically, this was the only driver who I could say definitely wasn't at fault.
Yeah, definitely there. Valgren there was on the outside. Well, it was the third car in the train. It was just 2 into 1, wouldn't go. Greg Sykes was threatening all the way down through the Cascades to go down the inside, put his nose down on the inside. Maybe it was a little bit of 2 into 1, didn't go. Maybe not enough room was given. Maybe he thought the car there of Candio thought that Greg Sykes would back out. But Greg Sykes, of course, a very prominent 2K Cup racer in both the Skip Barber and the Formula Renault. So really showing here, Will, that he was trying to put his knowledge to an advantage, but it just didn't apply in theory.
Yep. So we're just having a look then at your driver in P2. This is Lucas Gott in the MSP driver's home car. Up the crest he comes for his laps, down in towards the his lap chicane. As behind Hugo Prieto, Rafael Drascas. This battle continues. Hugo Prieto is now back inside of your top 10, looking for a little bit more. Rafael Drascas just a little bit ahead. And in terms of lap times last time by, Hugo Prieto, 0.7 seconds faster. So this is one that we will get to enjoy before the end of this motor race, Jay.
Yes, it will. Rafael Drascas has got to be careful right now there in that number 12 machine, down into the right left of Hislops he comes along, and he's just got to be cautious right now. He can just sit there and be calm, and he's got 3 laps to go to when he crosses the line. He's just got to keep the car on the racing line, because it's just so difficult around here, Will, to just get it down around the outside of someone, down the inside of someone. You just got to be up there really close. But if you keep your car on the racing line, you're pretty much guaranteed for 3/4 of a lap that nobody's going to get past you.
Yeah, we're looking at Torben Fairhair on replay here. Ah, he loses it under braking, almost takes out the sign, takes out the cone. Apologies to the family of that cone, but, well, Torben there losing positions as a consequence. Late on, people get more aggressive looking for things that may not be there. And now Torben, rather than gaining positions over David Soranzo, has lost a position to Petr Slimanek there. 2 laps of this motor race to go, and a couple of outstanding battles still to decide. Nick Thiessen, Mark Jarvis, having a look there, Thiessen is actually now lapping faster than Jarvis. But we know Thiessen had issues at the beginning of this event, wondering maybe he was just brave, saving some tyres for the last couple of laps.
Yeah, that could definitely be one way of looking at it. 29.5 meets a 29.8. Mark Jarvis for Carbon Racing under a little bit of pressure now. The gap is 0.8 seconds, and 0.8 can go in a blink of an eye around here. But Mark Jarvis, ever the esteemed, ever the quick driver, of course, and part of the Jarvis brothers duo at Carbon Racing, really going to try and show what he's made of right now. And he's only got one more lap after this to hold on, Will. My bet, I think he can at the moment, because that gap isn't really closing by my view.
Yes, but one that will go down to the wire. Hugo Prieto, Rafael Drascas, although we've had an incident somewhere. Mark Jarvis, Lando Norris, or something's happened to Lando Norris. We'll get confirmation of that. White flag is out, but Lando Norris has actually fallen out of everything. Lando Norris seems to be out of the motor race, potentially disqualified there on the final lap of the motor race, just because he over-abused track limits too much. We'll get confirmation of that one once the race is complete.
Well, he smacked it off at Druids there. It was just one of those really weird incidents. Just gets one tyre off of the rumble strip, and a car just speared into the inside wall, and that ended his day.
Oh, my word. So, yeah, his car is out. He did push a little bit too wide, and he did abuse the track limits. Let's get ourselves a replay then if we can. Lando Norris, we're on board of him. Runs the curb, runs the second curb, touches the white line, and thank you for coming, Lando Norris, out of the motor race, right at the very end of things. But Peter Berriman then, now just has a couple of corners left to go in the Apex Racing UK car. Here he comes. into Ward, Druids, exit of Druids, through Warwick Bridge with a final time, in towards Lodge Corner he will come, and Peter Berriman will dominate here at Oulton Park. 5.7 seconds will be the gap when all is said and done. Peter Berriman will win out here for Apex Racing UK. Second, the fastest lap of the day to boot as well. A 128.9. Lucas Gotch, the MSP driver's home car, coming home in second. And now we can see on board with Angus Waddle. He will round out your top three here today in that carbon racing machine. Three different teams then. And Mark Jarvis coming home in fourth. Also the carbon racing driver, Nick Thyssen, rounding out your top five. Well, we'll just get confirmation on the results in a moment. Hugo Prato, Rafael Draskas. Hugo Prato wasn't able to get himself the pass there over Rafael Draskas. That battle finished as was. Fantastic motor race here today, Jake. And of course, we've got it all to do again later on.
Yes, we do. Of course, we're coming back for what is the Formula Renault 2K Cup. That one's going to be an hour's racing. One pit stop is going to be required. It's all going to be about who keeps himself calm, who's going to keep their nerve. And with points at stake, everyone's going to be looking around their shoulders, hoping that they're the quickest driver. Quite a lot of drivers have been missing in the last couple of weeks. So hopefully we'll get a couple of them back. Hopefully we'll get a massive race.
Yep, you're going to Sebastian there, running out your field. Last driver on the lead lap, P number 18 for him. As then, let's go look at your final race results very quickly here, ladies and gentlemen. As you will see, it is Peter Berriman who wins out by 5.8 seconds over the competition here today. Lucas Gotch in second. Third place, Angus Waddle. Three different teams there on your podium. Apex Racing UK, MSP Drivers Home, and Carbon Racing. Mark Jarvis in fourth, Nick Thyssen in fifth, Unisalakivi in sixth, Rafael Draskas, Hugo Prato, Dan Nygaard, and David Taranto round out your top 10. There is the rest of the results up on your screen for you now. It is time for us to say goodbye, ladies and gentlemen, but we'll be back on air in 15 minutes' time for the classic IndyCar series from the famous Milwaukee Mile, the oldest operating oval in the world, plays host to the classic IndyCar series. That one coming your way in just 5-10 minutes time here on Racebot TV and on iRacing Live. Myself, Will Vinson, Jake Sperry, thanks for watching. Talk to you in a bit.